The importance of God's Word, or reading God's Word. That's what I want to bring to you today. How many times have you heard someone say these excuses on why folks don't read the Bible? Maybe you've been guilty of using them yourself. I think the Bible is just a book written by a bunch of men. How many times have you heard that? It's hard to understand. I don't really think it's important to read the Bible. I trust Jesus to save me, but I don't trust the Bible. How many times have you heard this? Even Donald Trump said the Bible is a spirit book. So there must be something to
keep that book. It's a spirit book.
Said it's a spirit book. 2 Timothy 2:15 says, "Be diligent to present yourselves approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." Be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. The Bible is the inspired Word of God. It's the inspired Word of God. I'll tell you how I got to this sermon here. And there's a person here that actually inspired me to preach on this. In our house on Sunday, me and Jeff and Ronnie, we prepare our meals for the week because we're in the gym every night. So we try to eat right. So on Sunday, we make our meals for the whole week. And we spend the whole day together. And so they had to eat dinner, then we had to move. Because I had a little room in my house that I had a little projector. And we watched a movie. And 2 or 3 weeks ago, Angelina was home. And me and Jeff wanted to watch Noah. Well, Angelina, I don't know if you know or not, but she's got an attitude. She come unglued. I mean, absolutely unglued. You are not watching that movie. It has nothing to do with the Bible. I can't believe you would even bring it into this house. I mean, she read me the Bible. And of course, we didn't watch the movie. Because I know better. So, she went to England. So what does Jeff do the next week? He brings the movie. And we watched it. And it was everything she said it was. It's not biblical. It's just a propaganda movie for the Saving Earth crowd, or the mobile motion. And I see that, and I see what the message was. But I don't know that Jeff really understood it. And it caused him to start reading his Bible. And he told me that next day that he started reading the Bible. And I said, he did. I started reading Genesis. I said, well. He said, now I know what Angelina was talking about. Now I know what's not biblical and what is. And he's been reading it every night. So it led me to preach this message today. Because reading your Bible is important. It's not just a book that should be left on the shelf. It should be read by everybody, especially Christians. Because the Bible is the inspired Word of God. It's not just a book written by men. 2 Peter 1:21, it says, "For the prophecy never came by the will of man, but by holy men of God, spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit." The Bible was written by God and penned by man. I'm going to give you a big theological term. It says plenary inspiration. And God is back to going, yeah, I know what that means. Because he's a doctor. It means the whole Word of God is inspired. The whole Word, not just parts of it. You see, when these guys were writing the Word of God, it was almost like God possessed them and told them what to write. Everything that they wrote was inspired by God. The whole Word. The whole Word. The Bible is profitable to anyone who reads it. Anyone. Even Donald Trump. The Bible is profitable to anyone who reads it. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. All scripture is given by the inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. That the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. That the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. God's word is eternal. That means there's no beginning and no end. God's word was in the beginning. John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now the Jehovah Witnesses, they put an A there. They say the Word was a God. But that's not what Scripture says. The Word was God. God's Word will never pass away. Never pass away. Matthew 24:35. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. God's word will never pass away. God's word is eternal. Jesus is God's word. The word became flesh. John 1:14 says, and the word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, and the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. God's word is truth. The Old and New Testaments lead us to Jesus. Luke 24:44 says, then he said to them, these are the words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms concerning me. See, Jesus was prophesied in the Old Testament. The Old Testament talks about Jesus. That's what it's about. So when we come to believe in Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we should have a hunger for God's word. It should be natural, since Jesus is God's word. Jesus promised to reveal himself to us through his word. The Holy Spirit will teach us God's word. We have a teacher. The Holy Spirit will fill us and teach us God's word. John 14:26 says, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. How many times you talk to somebody, someone that's unsaved, and you're debating them or answering their questions, and all of a sudden something pops up and you say it to them, and you go, where'd that come from? Happens to me all the time. I have no idea how I remembered it. I have no idea how I got there. I have no idea how I said it. It's the Holy Spirit. When you read God's Word and you get God's Word in you, you get into the Word and get God's Word in you, the Holy Spirit will recall it. When it's needed. It brings to your remembrance all things that I said to you. The Holy Spirit will always lead us to give Jesus all the glory. You know, I think it was, I think Ronnie brought me something the other day that this preacher had a revelation. It was about Donald Trump, you know, but it was a revelation. He said that God spoke to him, and Ryan was curious of is it real? How do we know it's real? Well, the Holy Spirit will lead us to give Jesus all the glory. If it contradicts with the Word, it's not from Jesus. I don't care how good it sounds. So if you know God's Word, like Pastor Tom says, when you train on counterfeit bills, you look at the real one and know it back and forth. So when a counterfeit comes along, you know it right away. The only way you'll know that is getting into God's Word. Because the Holy Spirit will always lead us to give Jesus the glory. John 16:13-15. However, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own authority. But whatever he hears, he will speak. And he will tell you things to come. He will glorify me for Jesus. He will glorify me, for he will take of what is mine and declare it to you. All things that the Father has are mine. Therefore I say that he will take of mine and declare it to you. So whatever is Jesus, whatever is God, the Father, the Holy Spirit will declare it to us. He's the Spirit of truth. An unbeliever can find Jesus by reading God's word without even hearing a sermon. You believe that? Jim Elliot's story. I don't know if you're any familiar with it. But Jim Elliot was a missionary that went down, I think it was the Amazon jungle, I'm not quite sure, either Brazil or Venezuela, to a people that were cannibals, and they were vicious people. Anybody that ever went to them got killed. And he flew down there with four or five other men, and they got killed. The the natives killed him. But his Bibles were left behind, and I think they translated the Bibles in their language. Well, Jim Elliot's wife, and I think some of the wives of the men that got killed, went down and finished their mission. And when they got down there, the natives weren't so savage, because they were reading God's word. And it turns out that they converted the whole colony. And they're all Christians. And they're still down there today. His kids and his kids' kids are still down there today with the mission. So an unbeliever can find Jesus just by reading God's word, never hearing a sermon. A believer will find Jesus in the Bible and in both Old and New Testaments. So when we study the Bible, we should always expect to find Jesus Christ. Because he is to be found from the beginning to the end. He is to be found in the Old and New Testament. Both. He said, if you seek him, you will find him. Jesus said, if you seek me, you will find me. Psalms 119:105. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Matthew 22:29 says, Jesus answered and said to them, you are mistaken, not knowing the scriptures, nor the power of God. If you don't know the scriptures, you don't know the power of God. 2 Timothy 4:3 says, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, because they have itchy ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers. People go after what makes them feel good. We were talking about that this morning in Sunday school. They don't care about sound doctrine. They care about what makes them feel good. Because they don't know their Bible. How many of us read and study our Bible every day? Ask that question to yourself. How many of you read and study your Bible every day? A recent poll showed that only 30% of the leaders in the church, 30%, pastors, deacons, lay pastors, etc., read and study the Word of God daily. 30%. That's the leaders. That's a tragedy. Today, many sell their Bible time for other commodities. Is reading the Bible optional? Is reading the Bible optional? I don't think it is. You discipline the flesh to study and meditate on God's Word? Do you discipline yourself to read God's Word? We discipline ourselves for a lot of other things. Especially if we like sports. Especially if we like doing other things. I like working on cars and building my rods. I discipline myself to do that. I work out every night. It's a discipline. It's not easy. But do I discipline myself to read God's Word? That's the question. And that's the most important question. I'm going to read you legacies and you think to yourself which one you want to leave. I preached last summer on legacy. Max Jukes lived in New York. He did not believe the Bible. And he thought the church was full of hypocrites. He was right. It's a good place for hypocrites. He never attended or allowed his children to go to church. He had 1,026 descendants. 300 of them were sent to prison for the average term of 13 years. 190 were public prostitutes. 680 were alcoholics. And many of them live in the welfare system and have not contributed to society. Jonathan Edwards lived in New York at the same time as Jukes. He read his Bible daily, loved the church. He and his family went to church every Sunday. He had 929 descendants, almost the same. 430 were ministers of the gospel. 86 were college or university presidents. 75 authored a book. 5 served in U.S. Congress. 2 served as senators. And 1, Aaron Burr, the 3rd Vice President of the United States under President Thomas Jefferson. None were ever in the welfare system. Not one cost the state a penny. They were serious contributors to their church and to this nation. The difference was the Bible, the church, and the Holy Spirit. Which legacy do you want for your family? I think the biggest problems with folks reading the Bible today is that we think we're too busy for the world. It's funny that we're too busy to read the Bible, but we're not too busy to do other things. We spend precious Bible reading time doing stuff that doesn't matter. Stuff that doesn't matter. Do it all the time. We think we're not going to understand it. And we would rather hear someone else tell us what's in the Bible than read it for ourselves. The most important one, and I think, we can't handle the truth. We can't handle the truth of God's Word because it offends us. Many don't want to be confronted by their sin or their lack of obedience. Just keep that mirror of the Word away from me. Ignorance is bliss. If I don't look into the mirror, I don't have to worry about it. What I look like. God's Word is like a mirror, and a lot of the times we don't want to see what's in the mirror. We don't want to see the ugliness of our life. A mountain man from Tennessee had never seen civilization or a mirror. He and his wife came upon a vacated campsite. Some people had left some food supplies and a mirror. So the man picked up the mirror and looked into it, and it scared him. He said, "I'll be a picture of my old pappy." It was sentimental to him, so he wanted to keep it. He thought his wife wasn't looking, so he hid it under the mattress. But the wife had seen him hide it, so when he was gone, she went and got it. She looked into it, and it startled her. She said, "So that's the old hag he's been running around with." Sometimes we need to look at the man. Sometimes we need to look at that mirror and realize it. The mirror of truth is the best mirror. Sorry about that. Jim Elliot quotes, "He is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain that which he cannot lose. He is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain which he cannot lose." Wherever you are, be all there. Live to the hilt every situation you believe to be the will of God. In other words, give 110%. Give God 110%. My father lived by this. My father did not do anything unless he could give 110%. If he was not able to give it, he wouldn't do it. And he impounded that into me. And I tried to impound it with my kids. If you're going to do something, do it 110%, especially when it comes to God. Another quote from Jim Elliot says, "When the time comes to die, make sure that all you have to do is die." When the time comes to die, make sure that all you have to do is die. The Bible is the inspired Word of God. God's Word is eternal. Jesus is God's Word. Jesus promised to reveal Himself to us through His Word. If you want to know Jesus, get involved. It's not good for us to go physically hungry. If we stop eating, we're probably going to die. And if we don't eat the right food, we're going to get sick. So it's definitely not good for God's people to go spiritually hungry. Or eat their own spiritual food. So my advice to you is read and study the Word of God. And I promise you won't regret it. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your Word. Thank you for the Holy Spirit. Thank you for the fact that we can count on it to be in truth. And Father, sometimes we look into it and we don't like what we see. We don't like to see that mirror of truth. But Father, I just ask that you give us a hunger for your Word and a hunger to get to know you. So in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.